Hi, good morning, everybody. Welcome to Disciple Church. I'm Charm Robarts. It's good to have you here. I'm glad we can be together in this way. Bill and Hans and I have prepared some things for you today. It makes us really happy to see your name on the registration list. We get those reports, and we're just always glad to see your names and to think of you. You know what? It's July the 5th. We're halfway through the year. I've heard some people say, good riddance to 2020, and we're only halfway done. Yeah, it's natural and normal to feel sad. I felt a bit of it myself last week. I wonder if you have felt sad over this. As I said, it is natural and normal to have those feelings. There's many things to be concerned about. Our neighbors are in need, perhaps we are in need. The health concerns, the economy, the fact that we don't know yet when we're going to get to come back to church and to hug each other. So many things in your life and mine are not what we had hoped they would be. And so if you're feeling sad, I hope you'll remember that you're not alone. We are not alone. And the way that God works in the world is through other people. So don't be afraid to reach out and say, I just want to talk about feeling sad. Or if you're not feeling sad, maybe you could reach out and offer that conversation with someone else. Good conversation is like balm for the soul. Well, I'm glad that you're here. Let's begin now with prayer.
Good morning. Let us pray. The question, O God, is not whether you seek to bless America, or, for that matter, every other nation on the earth. You do that all the time. The question is whether we and every person on the earth live so as to bless you. You seek to nurture and enrich each and every one of your beloved children. And look at us. Look at the disparity between rich and poor all over the world. Some people throw half their food away in the garbage, while others starve to death. Some people use guns and destructive force to bind and bend others to their will, while others are deprived both of the means and freedom to nurture themselves and others. No, neither Americans nor the people of any nation can sing and ask for your blessing. It is your nature to seek to bless one and all. No, we do not need to sing God Bless America. What we should sing is, God seeks to bless us in America and every person in every nation on the earth. May each and every one of us so live in love that we might bless you, O God, and your loving ways. We pray as Jesus taught.
I'm finding myself at a loss for words, and the funny thing is, it's okay. The last thing I need is to be heard, but to hear what you would say. Word of God, speak, would you pour down like rain, washing my eyes to see your majesty, to be still and know that you're in this place. Oh, please let me stay and rest in your holiness, Word of God, speak. I'm finding myself in the midst of you, beyond the music, beyond the noise, and all that I need is to be with you, and in the quiet hear your voice, Word of God, speak. Would you pour down like rain, washing my eyes to see your majesty, to be still and know that you're in this place. Please let me stay and rest in your holiness, Word of God, speak. Would you pour down like rain, washing my eyes to see your majesty, to be still and know that you're in this place. Please let me stay and rest in your holiness. I'm finding myself at a loss for words, and the funny thing is, it's okay.
In just a minute, Bill will lead us in receiving the bread and cup, that weekly observance of the fact that we are joined together as the body of Christ. We are joined together by the Spirit of Christ. Before we do that, we always pay attention and remember the wonder of the world in which we live, the vastness of the universe, the sun and moon and stars, the planets, the mystery of the oceans and of the mountains, the pine trees that do not forget their recipe for renewal. And all of these remind us that it is a gift to be alive, to be a part of this wonderful world. And so we give thanks. And we also remember the teachings of Jesus, which have stood for 2,000 years, reminding us of hope, reminding us that we are loved by God, that God is for us, but also disturbing us and asking us to wake up and to remember what should be and what could be. Therefore, Holy God, grant that in praise and thanksgiving, our lives may show the mystery of faith. Pour out your Holy Spirit on us and on these gifts of bread and cup, that through Christ's presence, we may become a beacon of holy light, a source of joy, a witness for peace. By your Spirit, make us one with Christ, one with each other, one with seekers far and near, and one in ministry to all the world.
Amen. Amen. Amen.
A little bit ago, I was talking with you about the teachings of Jesus when we were doing the Great Thanksgiving, and how that those teachings have stood the test of time. As you know, those teachings are scattered throughout the four Gospels. Some of them we find in the parables. Sometimes we find Jesus in conversations with people in which he's asking questions and they're asking questions. And then we have these two sermons, as we call them, in Matthew, the Sermon on the Mount, and in Luke, the Sermon on the Plain. These two bodies of material share much of the same content, and they both contain, or they both begin with, what we call the Beatitudes. We call them Beatitudes because that word is something like the Latin word for blessing. And so here are those Beatitudes. Blessed are the poor in spirit, for theirs is the kingdom of heaven. Blessed are those who mourn, for they will be comforted. Blessed are the meek, for they will inherit the earth. Blessed are those who hunger and thirst for righteousness, for they will be filled. Blessed are the merciful, for they will be shown mercy. Blessed are the pure in heart, for they will see God. Blessed are the peacemakers, for they will be called the children of God. And blessed are those who are persecuted for righteousness' sake, for theirs is the kingdom of heaven. Now, how do we make sense of these Beatitudes, of these nice things that Jesus said? Blessed are all these kinds of people. And there were all kinds of people possibly hearing this. In the chapter before the sermon, Matthew takes time to mention the places that Jesus had been doing his teaching and the places where people had come from to hear him. They were from Syria, Decapolis, Jerusalem, Galilee, which meant there were Jews and Greeks and rich and powerful and weak who were hearing the words of Jesus. Also, it might have been that John's disciples were in the crowd, since a few pages earlier than the sermon, we find John pointing his disciples toward Jesus. And so, it's a diverse crowd. And as you know, in a diverse crowd, everyone hears words with their own filters. Listeners, depending on what they already know or think they know, what they are looking for, will hear something one way or another. Maybe that's why Jesus often said, "Let the one who has ears to hear, hear." He's calling people to open their ears and their hearts and maybe to get ready for a new understanding. He starts with, "Blessed are the poor in spirit." We have to know this is a negative term. The poor in spirit are at the end of their rope. It's not a good place to be. This is not something you're trying to become. It's not something you want to attain to. I know sometimes those of us who teach and preach, myself included, have said, well, you know, it means to be poor in spirit means to know your need for God. Maybe we said that because it's easier to say, blessed are you when you know your need for God, than it is to say, blessed are you when you're poor. But that is what Luke says. Luke says in his version, blessed are the poor. Yours is the kingdom of heaven. Matthew says, blessed are the poor in spirit, which maybe at first sounds a little bit better to us. But really, when you think about it, when you think about how the poor are described in other places in Scripture, they are brokenhearted, they are oppressed, they are neglected, they are downtrodden, and in real life, they are oppressed, they are afflicted, they are neglected, they are out of privilege. No doubt the poor could feel poor in their spirits. I think Matthew's saying the same thing as Luke. He just reminds us that to be poor brings more than physical suffering. Again, this is not a condition that we want to attain to. And so that's something for us to think about on another day when we're talking about these Beatitudes. What are they about? Are they transactional? Do this and then get that? The idea of knowing our need for God certainly has merit, but I just don't think we should hang it here. I don't think we should avoid that Jesus was talking about the poor. So if these people are poor, the poor in spirit, the downcast, the discouraged, what on earth does it mean for God, for Jesus to say, blessed are you? You've probably heard it said that blessed means something like congratulations or happy. And while that could be technically true of this word that appears in the Greek text,
contextually, it just doesn't work. Congratulations if you're poor. Happy are you if you mourn to take up that second beatitude? It just doesn't make sense, does it? So then what? Well, several contemporary Christian teachers and preachers have offered up something like, God is for you. You who are poor, God is for you. God is on the side of the poor. Jesus starts his sermon with an announcement. God is on the side of the poor. Blessed are the poor. Not congratulations because you are poor. Blessed because God is on your side. God is on your side if you are down and out. Well, let's think about who that might be right here in Fort Worth, Texas. Well, obviously, poor people might be those who are choosing between medicine and rent. They might be the people who are working 32 hours, not because they're too lazy to work 40, but because they can't get a job that offers them 40 hours. Some companies don't or can't provide the benefits that are required by law to people who work 40 hours. These are the people who are juggling their paychecks to pay electricity. They sometimes take out loans with exorbitant interest rates because how else are they going to pay for housing and food? And if they have a car, what if it breaks down? Where's the money for that? These are the poor. And it's easy to see how that those people could feel poor in their spirits. God is on their side. Something I read the other day raised a question that's been important for me. Is it hard for us to read this because we have an implicit bias toward the poor? Meaning that do we think, without being conscious of it, do we think that poor people are poor because they don't work hard enough? That is an actual, real cultural bias. That people are down and out, both physically and spiritually, because of their own fault. I consider myself to be a cultural critic, but I know I am also influenced by the culture that I critique, which makes it even more important for me, for us, I think, to not avoid that Jesus was talking about the poor. And it's possible that sticking with that long-standing interpretation that the poor in spirit means we recognize our need for God is a way to avoid the real challenge, which is to get on the side that God is on the side of the poor. I find this challenging, do you? Because my friends, if God is for the poor, who are we supposed to be for? It's tough, isn't it? I feel staggered when I think very hard about it. American policymakers and economists argue about addressing poverty. And a big part of those arguments have to do with financial assistance programs. Some say that the policy began in 1964 with President Johnson's War on Poverty has worked, but we still have more work to do. Opponents say, no, those social benefit programs have been a failure and they've made the problems worse. Different ways of measuring poverty and outcomes are at the crux of this problem, this disagreement over the policies that are in place. Jesus was right when he said, the poor you always have with you. He wasn't saying that he was glad about that. He's saying, this is how human behavior is. Both behavior maybe of the poor and of those who are not poor who make the policies. He was observing human behavior. And while it may be true that some poor people have made choices that contribute to their difficult situations, who among us has not made poor choices? And then there's the matter of privilege, which makes some people's poor choices easier to get by with. We know these things, don't we? We know the complexity of poverty, But we also hear God is on the side of the poor. It doesn't mean that God is not on the side of the rich, but it's important for us to focus here on what Jesus is saying in this place so that we can begin to see ourselves on that side too. So that improving policy and education and tax policies and access to public services, affordable housing and so forth are also our concern. That will happen. It does happen. When we see that if God is on the side of the poor, that's where we want to be also. And on those days when we do see that, we find ourselves in the kingdom of heaven. Amen.
Jesus had taught them for the afternoon, and they were tired and hungry. And some of the disciples came to Jesus and said, "Should we go into the village and get some food?" And one of the disciples said, "Here's a little boy. He's got 5 loaves and 2 fishes, which makes up 7, which is the complete number in Hebrew liturgy. Namely, there are 7 days to the week, and when 7 days are done, the week is complete." And Jesus took the bread, and he blessed it, and he broke it, and he gave it to the crowd. And it was enough to feed 5,000, with 12 baskets left over, 1 basket for each of the tribes of Israel. And hence enough to feed the whole world. In Jesus, as the revelation of God's love, the bread is the bread of life. Let us partake of the bread of life. Jesus took the cup. Again, he blessed it and gave it to them to drink. In Jesus' revelation of God's love, the cup has become the cup of blessing and has become the cup of the joy of our lives. Let us partake of the cup. Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come. Thy will be done on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our trespasses, as we forgive those who trespass against us. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom, and the power, and the glory forever.